Hello and welcome to Hornbill TV's Prime at 9. I'm Naomi Kigon. Now the news in detail. Sri Lanka President Gotabaya Rajapaksa emailed a letter of resignation to the Parliament Speaker late on Thursday, a source familiar with the matter told news agency Reuters. It was not immediately clear if the letter sent shortly after Rajapaksa arrived in Singapore would be accepted in email form, the source added. Rajapaksa landed in Singapore on Thursday after fleeing mass protests over his country's economic meltdown as troops patrolled the commercial capital Colombo to enforce a curfew. Rajapaksa, who fled to the Maldives on Wednesday to escape a popular uprising over his family's role in a crippling economic crisis, headed on to Singapore on a Saudi Arabian airline flight, according to a person familiar with the situation said. A passenger on the flight who declined to be named told news agency Reuters that Rajapaksa was met by a group of security guards and was seen leaving the airport VIP area in a convoy of black vehicles. The Supreme Court on July 14 slammed the Nagaland government for delaying the process of implementing the proposed 33% reservation for women in local bodies, even after multiple directives from the Supreme Court. The Apex Court 10 asked the Nagaland State Election Commission to inform the court by when they would notify the elections of municipalities and town councils. During a hearing of the same in April, the state of Nagaland had informed the Supreme Court of its decision to implement 33% reservation to women, and accordingly, the Supreme Court directed the State Election Commission to inform of the schedule of elections. Appearing for the state government, Advocate General K.N. Balgobal informed that the government had given the administrative approval to the State Election Commission. However, the court noted that the approval was received only on July 12. Taking note of this, the court highlighted the lackadaisical attitude in the matter. The court said that the Nagaland government has delayed at each stage to keep the rights of women further, adding that it is not only when the matter is before the court that something is done. As the hearing drew to a close on July 14, the court further pointed to the state's representative, Advocate General K.N. Balgobal, and said that the court does not have any trust in the state government. 12 years, something which could have been automatically done, requires so much effort. Very sad state, the court pointed. You talk about gender equality. This is a part of the country where women are extremely educated. They are required all over the country, the bench added. The report is once again a reflection on the lackadaisical attitude of the state government, even in furtherance of assurances given to this court, apart from the fact of the legal mandate which they are required to follow, the bench observed. At this point of the hearing, Balgobal pointed out that two women AGs were appointed, adding that the wind is changing at this juncture, to which the court quickly replied that the wind is going too slow and it needs to go faster. The next hearing is scheduled for July 29. Deputy Commissioner Woka Ajit Kumar Ranjan in a press communique requested the commanding officer 89 RCC Kohima and the executive engineer PWD RNB Woka Pakti Division to furnish all relevant records pertaining to taking over of the Botsa Bogachan Road by the Border Road Organization within 2 days, considering the urgency of the matter. The communique further stated that the poor condition of Botsa Bogachan Road from Hangkudo to Rengmapani has been brought to the notice of District Planning and Development Board and has been decided to urgently address all the issues regarding its maintenance. It informed that meeting in regard to Botsa Bogachan Road was held with public organization EEPWD, RNP and GREF representative, and had also emerged that immediate works are required at Tukchung Nala Bridge. The statement further stated that there are interdepartmental differences over alignment and responsible agencies for the Botsa Bogachan Road stretch, which are hampering the works, causing undue pain to public. Chumukedima Town Angami Mechu Groto, the apex body of all CSOs under Chumukedima Town, in its general meeting unanimously resolved to further reaffirm to the Angami public organization and Chumukedima Public's resolution adopted on February 14, 2017 at Weekly Market Chumukedima Town for one government, one tax. The press communique stated that no taxation will be paid to any entity unless the Naga political groups come together to work collectively for one cause. The statement further appealed to all the business community to reach the anti-extortion team helpline at 8787893133 for any assistance. The statement warned that any business person willingly complying with the demands of illegal taxation will be expelled from Chumukedima jurisdiction and will be banned from conducting any business activity in future. In a press statement, the Chumukedima Town Angami Mechu Groto asks the Chumukedima Town Youth Organization to remain vigilant for movement of any group collecting tax around the jurisdiction of Chumukedima Town. The union further appealed the Chumukedima Town Women Organization and Chumukedima Town Youth Organization to jointly conduct checking for bootleggers and drug abusers, peddlers around the town's vicinity and to take strict action against anyone found involved in carrying out illegal activities. Nagaland Chief Minister Nifirio handed over various music equipments to 12 districts today at his residence as part of a program initiated by the Task Force for Music and Arts. Rio said people outside think differently about the state when they read about the insurgency and issues such as the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. They think differently about the state and as music activities in the state motivate the youths to divert from the bad attention. Otherwise, the people are a peaceful people whose youths are very talented, he added. The chief minister also announced to give one each of 15 KVA to all the districts.
So with that lockdown period, you might have experienced so many bad things also, learned good things also, and also be thinking positively so that we come back with new vigor and fresh ideas. So that I encourage you, and also government will have more support for you if you come forward. The musical talents of our youth are huge. There's huge potentials, and I feel that we can progress slowly. I was more fond of purpose, and I've been helping even musicians or helping youths, which I will continue.
Thank you, sir.
So, like those of you who are in music, or whichever discipline you are, you try to grow and become professionals. Really take it seriously, because I used to say that our society is educated, but not matured and civilized. We still have that, a lot of weaknesses. And civilizations doesn't take overnight. So we grow strength to strength, and that's how we would like to continue to support you.
Also, advisor for the TAFMA, Teja Meru, informed that there were 12 districts partnered with the Music Task Force and Arts, while 4 new districts were yet to impaneled, which is in process though.
The 12 districts, okay. The 4 new districts we are yet to impanel, we are under process. We are getting entries, people are writing to us, but we will choose most appropriate agencies or societies to support us. And so one thing I must mention is all the our partners are volunteers. They are all volunteers, there's nothing they get from government, but they share love for music. They partner with us to support the younger boys and girls in the district so that we can identify talents and promote them further in our TAFMA programs, TAFMA shows, which
professionally.
At least 17 people were killed on Wednesday as heavy rains triggered landslides and floods, forcing thousands of to move to safety amid fast-filling water reservoirs and swollen rivers in various parts of the country. In Telangana, the Telangana government announced education institutes in the state will remain closed till Saturday due to continuous rain that inundated low-lying areas and damaged road links in several places. In Maharashtra's Palghar, Pune city and the neighboring Pimpri Chinchwad area, schools and colleges will remain shut on Thursday due to a heavy rain forecast. Rains have wreaked havoc in Maharashtra, causing a landslide in the Palghar district that killed a man and his daughter, while 4 people were swept away in overflowing streams in the Gondia district. Both Palghar and Gondia districts have been witnessing very heavy rains since Tuesday night that inundated low-lying areas. Following the landslide in Palghar, at least 40 families in the neighborhood of Wakralpada have been shifted to safety. Rains, however, continued to elude Delhi, as the city has so far recorded 148.2 mm of rainfall against a normal of 149.7 mm since June 1. Despite light rains in the morning, high humidity oscillating between 68% and 95% caused discomfiture during the day. In the west, heavy showers in parts of South Gujarat and Kutch Saurashtra regions since Tuesday left 14 people dead, while over 31,000 were evacuated so far this season. Valsad District Administration asked people to go to safer places as water levels in Auranga River continue to rise. The administration also shared the emergency number 02632-240212. 3 national highways in Kutch, Navsari and Tang districts were blocked, while 51 state highways and over 400 panchayat roads have also been damaged, State Disaster Management Minister Rajendra Trivedi said. As rains continue to wreak havoc in different parts of Karnataka, Chief Minister Basavaraj Bommai said 32 people have lost their lives so far and rupees 500 crore will be released immediately to restore the basic infrastructure that got damaged. Rivers in the region have swelled, several dams have reached the brim, and there is severe waterlogging in agriculture fields and low-lying areas, causing damage to crops and properties. Similar is the situation in adjoining districts of Shivamoga, Chikamakuluru and Hassan. With the Tungabhadra Dam almost reaching its capacity and increasing water flow in the river, there are threats of some of the monuments at the heritage site of Hampi like Burandara Mondawa getting inundated. In Odisha, very heavy rains battered many parts of the coastal state, causing a landslide in the Gajapati district that damaged at least 10 houses, while major roads in Malkangiri and Kalahandi districts were damaged. The IMD has forecast heavy to very rains in 9 southern Odisha districts in the next 2 days. The heavy rainfall has thrown life out of gear in the Motu area of Malkangiri district bordering Andhra Pradesh and Chhattisgarh. road communication between Malkangiri to Telangana, Andhra Pradesh and Chhattisgarh has been disrupted as rainwater up to a height of 6 to 8 feet was flowing on the road, an official said. The rainwater was also seen flowing over major roads in the Kalahandi district. Viewers sobbed and millions of fans were left teary as an awestruck as Britain's most decorated and loved athlete, Sir Mo Farah, after 39 years, finally revealed who he actually was and his entry into the country. He said, "I'm not who you think I am. This is a tragic yet successful story of one of Britain's most decorated Olympians."
Ahmed Mukhtar Jamal Farah, also known as Sir Mo Farah, enjoyed a remarkable career on the track, becoming the first British athlete to win 4 Olympic gold medals. He is a household name in Britain and also in the field of athletics. Mo Farah's first appearance at Olympics was in 2012 London Olympics, where he bagged the gold in both 5,000 meters and 10,000 meters. He also won gold in both category at the 2016 Rio de Janeiro Olympics. Farah was named a Commander of the Order of the British Empire in the 2013 New Year's Honour list and received a knighthood in the 2017 list from Queen Elizabeth II. With so many achievements to his name, his past remained shrouded in mystery. Until now, when in a recent documentary with BBC, he finally garnered the courage to tell his true story. In his documentary, he said, at the age of 9, he was illegally trafficked from Djibouti to London under the name of another child and forced into child labour. "The truth is, I'm not who you think I am," the 39-year-old Somalia-born great told the BBC in a revelatory documentary about his life. In the revelations, he said he was brought to the UK illegally as a child and was forced to work as a domestic servant, he has repeated. The Olympic star has told he was given the name Mohammed Farah by those who flew him over from Djibouti, while his real name was Hussein Abdi Kahin. He was flown over age 9 by a woman he had never met and then made to look after another family's children, he said. For years, he just kept blocking it out, the Team GB athlete said. But you can only block it out for so long. The long-distance runner has previously said he came to the UK from Somalia with his parents as a refugee. In the documentary, he says his parents have never been to the UK. His mother and two brothers live on their family farm in the breakaway state of Somaliland. Further elaborating on his past, he said his father, Abdi, was killed by stray gunfire when Sir Mo was 4 years old in civil violence in Somalia. Sir Mo said he was about 8 or 9 years old when he was taken from home to stay with family in Djibouti. He was then flown over to the UK by a woman he had never met and wasn't related to. She told him he was being taken to Europe to live with relatives there, something he says he was excited about. "I'd never been on a plane before," he said. The woman told him to say his name was Mohammed. He said she had faked travel documents with her that showed his photo next to the name Mohammed Farah. When they arrived in the UK, the woman took him to a flat in Hounslow, West London, and took a piece of paper off him that had his relatives' contacts details on. "Right in front of me, she ripped it up and put it in the bin. At that moment, I knew I was in trouble," he said. Sir Mo says he had to do housework and childcare if I wanted food in my mouth. He said the woman told him, "If you ever want to see your family again, don't say anything. Often, I would just lock myself in the bathroom and cry," he said. Sir Mo's PE teacher, Alan Watkinson, noticed a transformation in the young boy when he hit the athletics track. "The only language he seemed to understand was the language of PE and sport," he said. Sir Mo says sport was a lifeline for him, as the only thing he could do to get away from this living situation was to get out and run. He eventually confided in Mr. Watkinson about his true identity, his background, and the family he was being forced to work for. The PE teacher contacted social services and helped Sir Mo to be fostered by another Somali family. "I still missed my real family, but from that moment, everything got better," Sir Mo said. "I felt like a lot of stuff was lifted off my shoulders, and it felt like me. That's when Mo came out, the real Mo." After the revelation, the Metropolitan Police said they have opened an investigation into Sir Mo Farah's revelation that he was trafficked to the UK as a child. The force says specialist officers will assess information the former Olympic athlete gave in a BBC documentary.
He's got eyeballs out now. Longest Seawell in second place. Aguida there. Legat coming wide. He got tripped though. And Mo Farah's coming down the straightway. And he's going to be attacked by Gebre Meskel. And Mo Farah's got the double. He's the Olympic champion again. Gebre Meskel gets the silver medal. And in third place is the second of the Kenyans. And what about that? Mo Farah is the Olympic 10,000 meter champion. He's the Olympic.
That's all for now. Keep watching Hornbill TV.